Offering service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Good afternoon, and welcome to Gardens of California. My name is Gerald Turney, and I'm your host and instructor. This is our second class of the semester. We had our first class 2 weeks ago, and we talked about peas a little bit last time, and watering your garden, how to water your garden, that you water your garden by the inch, and you need to know how many inches per hour your sprinklers apply, all that kind of stuff. We talked about water conservation. And we'll always be talking about water on this program because it's so important to maintaining your health of your garden. This is a live broadcast, and you can call in at any time with questions about your garden at 1-800-339-1193. Or you can email us questions as well. And there's our email address, askdhtvlive@gmail.com. So send us your questions. Today we're going to talk about winter gardens. We're going to talk about insects and the variety of insects that will eat your plants in your garden. But we like to start the show with upcoming events. So let's see if we have any upcoming events on our schedule and what you can schedule to do in the upcoming weeks. The Arden Park Garden Club Garden Tour will be on September 13th from 10 to 2. Gardens will display salvaged wood uses and charming uses of land, including vegetable, flowers, and water gardening. For more information, check their website at ardenparkgardenclub.com. In addition to that, we have the Thursday Garden Talks with Lily Singer at the Los Angeles County Arboretum. This is every Thursday, but the next one upcoming, September 18th. It is 9:30 to 12. Lily is a well-known garden writer and has hosted this series of talks for quite a few years at the Arboretum. She invites guest speakers, and you'll learn a lot about gardening if you go. Give them a call at 626-821-4623, or you can email Jill Berry at jillberry@arboretum.org. Jill Berry organizes all the classes there at the Arboretum. In addition to that, we have the South Bay Orchid Society Fall Show and Sale at the South Coast Botanic Garden in Palos Verdes, September 20th and 21st. On the 20th, it'll be 11 to 5, and on the 21st, which will be a Sunday, will be 9 to 4. The reason it starts later on Saturday is on Saturday morning, they've got to judge all the flowers and award the ribbons and prizes. If you have not been to a flower show, any kind of flower show, or if you haven't been to an orchid flower show, you should go to this. It will be spectacular. You will see so many different kinds of flowers, and you'll probably immediately want to grow orchids. So you can give that some thought. If you're interested in orchids, give us a call and we'll talk about growing orchids. We're going to have a whole show on orchids later in the semester. In addition to that event, let's see if we have another event. The Santa Barbara County Horticultural Society Plant Sale is coming up on September 27th and 28th, a good excuse to drive up to Santa Barbara and enjoy that wonderful area of California. On the 27th, 10 to 5, also 10 to 4 on the 28th. You know, the plant sales that the various organizations hold, the gardens and the horticultural clubs, you will get some of the most unusual plant materials. They will propagate things that are not in the trade, that you can't get at regular nurseries. So if you're interested in unique plant material, this is where you go get it, at the annual plant sales, either in this case, the Santa Barbara County Horticultural Society, or if you go to the plant sales for the Huntington or the Arboretum or Descanso Gardens or Fullerton or San Diego Botanic Garden, any of them, that's where you're gonna get some interesting plant materials. In addition to that, let's see if we have another event on our list. No, that's it for today. I just want to remind any students watching the show today that you do have to attend at least one outside event and write an essay about it and tell me what you learned. I just want to see that you went out and learned something new about gardening or plant materials or, you know, trees or anything to do with a garden or landscaping. So these are excellent events to attend. You can find your own event, something that you may be very interested in yourself. You don't have to go to something we list. And there's a lot of things to do. You can, like I just mentioned, you know, the various botanical gardens that are in Southern California. Descanso Gardens in La Cañada, the Huntington Botanical Gardens in San Marino, the Arboretum in Arcadia, Rancho Santa Ana out in Claremont, the Fullerton Arboretum at Cal State Fullerton, San Diego Botanic Garden down in San Diego. So those are all great places. Go to their websites. They all have events. They all have classes. They have free lectures quite often, usually once a month on a free day. That's an opportunity to go out and learn something new about gardening and actually get some really accurate and good information, because unfortunately there's a lot of misinformation out there, especially on some of the social media sites. I go on and I look at the YouTube videos quite frequently looking for quality videos to share with you. And unfortunately, for every good video I find a dozen that are just very poor with kind of crazy ideas. So the university websites usually have excellent information too. University of California, UMass has, University of Massachusetts has a wonderful fruit tree advisor series of videos. And I've used those many times to highlight how to prune various types of fruit trees. So you can get really good information that way. So let's see what we're gonna talk about. Now, before I move in and talk about insects, let's talk about what you can be doing in your garden right now. This is actually a very busy time of the year for gardening, especially if you grow annuals, if you grow a summer vegetable garden, if you're growing tomatoes and peppers, squash, corn, melons, beans. Those are all summer materials. For the most part, they're gonna stop producing right about now. If you got them in early, they might have stopped producing several weeks ago. My tomatoes are done. I've torn out all my tomatoes because I'm not going to get any more fruit, and they got pretty heavily infested with spider mites. Even though I sprayed several times and tried to keep them down, I did delay it, but they got the mites, and they do pretty much every year by the end of the summer. The mites have caught up to me, and I haven't sprayed quite as frequently as I should have. So the tomatoes are out. I'm getting ready for my winter vegetable garden and some winter herbs. But let's talk about some of the things I'm doing with my summer plants right now, so that next spring I'll be ready to start up again for summer materials. One of the things I'm doing is collecting seed from a variety of plants. Now this is a basil plant. And basil is one of my absolute favorite herbs to grow. And as you can see, it's starting to flower up here at the top. Now during the summer, when you're growing basil, you want to pinch off these flowers. You want to just pluck them out so you get leaf, because that's what you use basil for. And of course, basil is really a very potent herb. I make pesto out of it, but it can be used in a lot of different recipes. It's very easy to grow from seed. So you can either buy a pack of seed for $2 or $3, or every year you can collect seed from the plants you grew. So if you let these flowers grow and mature, you'll get quite a bit of seed. And I'll show you, let's take a quick look right here on the overhead at these old flowers from basil. If we can go to the overhead, and let's see if this is in the right spot for the camera to pick it up. If not, I'll move it around a little bit. There you go. So here are some old flowers, and these are mature, and if you just crush them, and hopefully the seeds are still in there, hopefully I haven't lost all the seeds, and you just crush them up, and there's our first seed right there. There's a seed. Here's a seed, here's a seed. And the nice thing about seeds often is you get a lot of this other stuff here. This is, you know, because I'm crushing it with my fingers. You crush this up with your fingers and there's a lot of little black seeds in here. So how do you separate them? Well, it's actually pretty easy. You just tilt this and kind of shake it and all the seeds will roll down the paper. And then I just push this debris about. And this is all seed right here. That's seed. I don't know if you can get in close, but of course I've been doing this for a while now. And here is all the seed that I've collected this week. So this is all basil seed. So I don't need to go out and buy a new pack of basil seed for next year. I've collected seed from my plants. And next February, I'll sow some of the seed in 4-inch pots or directly in the ground, and I'll start my new basil crop. Basil is a summer crop. You don't normally grow it in the winter. I guess you could try and grow it in the winter, especially if you were in a very warm, frost-free environment, you know, right along the coast or down in San Diego. You probably grow it in the winter even. I don't know how well it'll do in the winter, to tell you the truth. I don't ever try and grow it in the winter. I think it's just not going to do well. It might flower too quickly, and it might not be hot enough for it to grow well. So it really is, you start it in the spring, grow it all summer, and it's really fun to grow. And just one flower spike like this will give you quite a bit of seed. So I grew about 20, 30 basil plants just from seed last spring. I grew a lot of them in 4-inch pots. This one never got in the ground. And I've got enough seed already that I don't need to let that go to seed. I'll pluck those flowers off. I have quite a few in pots, and I'll be making some more pesto sometime this week. So this is a basil seed. I'm also collecting seeds from a variety of other plants right now. I'm collecting seed from columbine, which is a really pretty flower, and we'll seed in it. You can broadcast it and let it grow, or grow it in plant pots and then put them out where you want them. I grew a lot of sunflowers this year, and they did really well, and I thought I was going to get a lot of seed. Now, there's a beautiful sunflower behind me on the screen, and I expected to get these big sunflowers filled with seeds. Unfortunately, the introduced squirrel that is so prevalent now throughout Southern California, and particularly the San Gabriel Valley, but I see them everywhere. I think anywhere you've got trees and a lot of food for them, they're going to really, really get established. They're this small fox squirrel or foxtail squirrel. They're native to the eastern United States, but they've been in Southern California now for quite a long time. I think the first ones I saw were back in the 60s when I was mowing lawns going to junior college. But back then, they were just in a few neighborhoods. They weren't widespread. Now they're everywhere. Well, they took every one of my sunflowers. They ate every seed out of every sunflower in my garden. So I hope they're happy, because I really fed them well this year. They also took every one of my nectarines off my nectarine tree. So next year I'm going to put bird netting over my nectarine tree and keep them off. And I may get some traps and reduce the population of those squirrels, because they really spoiled my sunflowers. Now I'm going to set this over here and clean that up later. So the other thing is that if you like a color, you know, flower beds, now they use a lot of water. You water them pretty much like you water a lawn, and lawns use a lot of water. Things that don't use a lot of water, trees, shrubs in general, of course, drought-tolerant trees and drought-tolerant shrubs will leave even less water than kind of ordinary trees. But you know, usually you can have a spot here or there where you might have a little color. And so some of the more traditional materials that we alternate to in the winter months, now where it's cold in the United States, you know, where you get freezes and it snows, what we grow in the winter, they grow in the spring. So we grow it in the winter because we don't get cold enough. So what do we grow? Well, one of the most standards are pansies. And of course, pansies do use quite a bit of water. They're not drought tolerant. But this is the time of year you're going to want to start things like this. And pansies come in a huge variety of colors and sizes, from little tiny ones to big ones. And now back in a long time ago, you know, the little ones, they were always called, you know, Johnny Jump-Ups. You know, this is your standard pansy. And pansies are actually violets. They are hybridized. And the original parent was Viola tricolor and crossed with many other Viola species. And now you've got just so many different kinds of pansies. There's just thousands of them. But like I said, this is the time of year you want to get them in. If you get them in about mid-September and through October, then they'll have a little warm weather to grow up and get established before we get cold and they kind of stop growing. Once we get cold nights going into December and January, they're going to kind of stop a little bit. They're not going to grow too much. Now, if we stay warm, they may do quite well, continue. But you want to get them up and sized before it gets cold. So that's why you want to plant them in late September, the last 2 weeks of September, and through October. And then come February, you'll have flowers, and they'll bloom all through February, March, April, and into May. As soon as we get hot, they're going to suffer, and they're not going to look so good. So these are winter flowers. You want to get them in early. It includes pansies and snapdragons. Now, these snapdragons don't have any. I got this pony pack of snapdragons. This is six plants. This is a little pony pack of petunias. There's six plants. But snaps are another winter material. You don't grow them in the summer. All of these can be grown by seed, and I encourage everyone to grow everything but from seed. And something has happened here. Oh, here it is. Gotta watch these guys. Ah! I have some live insects, and they've really come to life. And they're wandering around. So what else can you grow for winter flowers? Well, Iceland poppies are fabulous. I see lobelia, but lobelia people grow year-round, but you know, you can put it in the winter too. So pansies, snapdragons, Iceland poppies. There's a wide variety of things you can grow in the winter months. Now, they won't freeze. That's really important, is even if we get a frost, your pansies will be fine. They'll tolerate a little bit of frost. Whereas some of the summer materials like petunias and marigolds will, and zinnias, things like that, which you plant in the spring and grow through the summer months, they're going to not like this cold winter months. Another thing that I picked up, because I just like them so much. Now, this guy's really on the march. And so I have a treat for you. I've got some live insects because we're talking about insects today, and I gotta just keep this guy corralled. But these are this is coleus. This is a little pack of coleus. I picked them up at Home Depot, and they just have the most incredible color to them, and they come in so many different colors. This is one of my favorites because of the dark red, really, really showy. Very easy to grow from cuttings, very easy to grow from seed. Now it's a little late in the year to be growing these. You're going to try and keep them alive through the winter months. Typically, you're going to want to grow these starting in the spring. They're not a really winter material at all. They're tender, they freeze. If they survive the winter and if we don't get a hard freeze, they'll survive the winter. But they'll get leggy, they'll get real tall. They won't have any leaves at the bottom, they'll just have a couple leaves at the top, they'll be leggy. So you cut them off, and they'll sprout more growth. And this guy really is on the move. He doesn't like being right there. And I mean, this is a real treat for us today to have live insects to share with you. So this is coleus. And what I'm gonna do is I'll pot these up and I'll try and keep them out where they get a little bit of morning sun. And then in the afternoon, protect them from the heat, especially because finally we're hot. Today is really quite hot out. In the San Gabriel Valley, it'll be 100 degrees, if not a little bit more. But that's to be expected. We've had a very cool summer here in Southern California these last couple months. And so a couple hot days in September, I can put up with that because we had a very cool August and very cool July too. So that was kind of a nice little treat after our extremely hot January. So these are coleus. They come in a wide variety of colors and easy to grow. And so I picked them up because they're so much fun to grow. And I, you know, my biggest problem is going to a nursery and not buying plants. The other one I picked up are these, what used to be called vinca, but actually the genus is Catharanthus, but a lot of people still refer to these as vinca. Come on, buddy, back. If you want to go to the overhead, let me just show you these vincas. Now, these have been highly hybridized, and they're so, the flowers are much bigger than they used to be. And these will freeze. They're a little tender. Typically, you grow these, start them in the spring. I went ahead and picked these up because I just want to see if I can get them into pots and keep them over the winter months if we don't get a hard frost. But you can see that they really, what surprised me was how much bigger the flower is on these than they used to be, you know, just 10, 20 years ago. So, you know, as they hybridize and develop newer varieties, they really do improve some of the effects. Now we're gonna talk about insects, but also I'm starting some more seed too. Let's go to the overhead and you'll see what I've been playing with here. Go to the overhead real quick and I'll show you these. And I'll tell you what, I usually have a mystery plant, but these are gonna be my mystery insect. And now this shouldn't be too big a mystery. These things right here are the frass or the poop, and this is a caterpillar. But I want you to tell me what kind of caterpillar this is and what plant you would find it on eating the leaves. Because caterpillars eat the leaves. They eat. They're chewing insects. And that's a big distinction. There we go. Now you can see the markings on it. And this guy is really trucking around. He's really doesn't like being out here in the open. There he goes. These are full size. They're about 3 inches long, about, you know, the width of your finger. Big fat caterpillar. And they're going to turn into a moth. This particular caterpillar turns into a moth. So if you recognize this caterpillar, give us a call and tell us what it is at 1-800-339-1193. Now let's go back to the overhead again. There's a couple other things. This is a great time to seed in a lot of color. You know, not necessarily pansies or something like that, which are kind of high water use, but there might be a spot or two. You can have a few pansies here and there. But here is California poppy. Let's go to the overhead and take a look at this seed pack. And this is a great time. Here's California poppy. I'm not advertising this particular brand of seed, but here's a little pack of poppies. And on the back, it tells you how to grow them. And then the other things, so you can just broadcast this in some open dirt and cover it lightly and get it wet a few times, and they'll come up like crazy. They're really quite easy to grow. And then on top of that, you know, something I haven't grown in the past is delphinium. So I got three different packs of delphinium. Now, delphinium is also, there's larkspur, which is delphinium, but larkspur tend to be smaller, and delphiniums tend to be bigger. And you start them in, if you start the seed now, then, boy, these guys just really want to take off. So they're wandering around. So it says right on here, it says cold winters, you know, this is for poppies. Cold winters, so where you get, you know, real snow, March to May, but in mild winters, September to April. So September is when you start your California poppy. So if you want to have some beautiful poppies next spring, you need to start the seeds right now. Now, if you want, you can go ahead and do them in pots, or you can broadcast them on the soil. And this is 1.5 grams or 2 grams for, you know, $3. So not a bad, you know, and a lot of color. And they'll seed themselves back in. So that's a lot of fun too. Yes, Mike, you know, I have a question from the control room. Did I lose a caterpillar? Well, they're trying to get away. They're on the run. Now here's the larkspur. It says 3 to 4 foot tall spires. But larkspur usually isn't that big. It says plant in September to November, so that's when you want to start this stuff. And go to the overhead again, you'll see our caterpillar on the march. Again, this is another delphinium packet, heirloom blue mirror. Flip it over, and it says plant in mild winters, August to September. So a good time to start your delphiniums. But there's a lot of seed, and there goes our caterpillar. And if you recognize it, give us a call. Big fat guys, they're both on the march. And I'm gonna have to corral them now because I can't be constantly having them take off. So some fun seed to grow. And there's lots of other seeds you can grow, but be careful. You know, make sure you're picking a seed or a plant that's appropriate for the winter months. And I'm going to let this guy march in here. And this one wants to march in there too. And then we'll talk about these guys. There they are. And let me see if I can just kind of prop this up a little bit. I don't want it to close on them. We're gonna leave it like that, and hopefully they won't cruise around too much. So let's talk about insects. And bring up our first picture behind me, and then we'll talk about how, you know, the various kinds of insects that can damage your garden. And there's two kind of broad groups of insects. There's even more than that, but let's just start with thinking of two broad groups of insects based on their mouth parts. There are insects that suck on plant juices that have a long kind of a tube called a proboscis, and they stick it into the plant, usually into soft tissue, like new growth or tender stems. And then they suck the juices out of the plant. So you have sucking insects. Then there are those insects that chew. And Those have chewing mouth parts. Those are mostly beetles, grasshoppers, caterpillars. Those are mostly your chewing insects. So it's important to recognize the two groups. So let's concentrate just for a minute on sucking insects. What you see behind me are aphids. Let's bring that up full screen. These are aphids on a rose bush, probably the most common place you're ever going to see aphids. They're also referred to as plant lice. Aphids are among the most destructive insect pests on cultivated plants. There are about 4,400 species and within 10 families. Many aphid species are monophagous, that is, they feed on only one plant species. But, you know, that's true, but many are also polyphagous and feed on anything. But the pea aphid feeds on hundreds of plant species. Aphids passively feed on sap of phloem. And let me, I always want to go back and make sure you understand the terms I'm using. Phloem is the conductive tissue in plants that moves the sugars that's made in the leaves. It is just underneath the epidermis, typically, or you can access it in the veins of leaves or in stems, as opposed to the xylem, which is the water-conducting tissue in a plant. And it's important to differentiate those two conductive tissues. They, of course, it's very important to understand those two tissues. So aphids feed on phloem. They're phloem feeders. And it's very sweet and sticky material. And they... My caterpillars just really, really don't like holding still. So I'm going to have to trap them in there. So they feed on this sticky phloem that passes through their body and drips off their rear end. Aphids do that a lot, but almost any sucking insect does that. And we'll talk about all the other kinds of sucking insects in a minute. So it drips off their rear ends. It lands on the lower leaves, and you get this sticky layer on the lower leaves below the aphids, and then mold will grow in that, what's called honeydew. What drips off their rear end is called honeydew. So you get this mold growing on it. We call that sooty mold. It's black. It'll be black. Variety of fungi will grow in that. They're just saprophytes. And then you take your thumb and you just rub it, you rub the leaf, and it rubs right off, and underneath it's green. So if you see sooty mold on your plants, whether it be, you know, on citrus, you go up, you see the lower leaves of the tree have all this black on them. You rub it off and it's underneath it's green. That's sooty mold. That tells you you've got sucking insects in the canopy of the tree that you need to bring under control. Let's see what else they talk about on aphids. We kind of covered that. Let's look at our next picture of aphids. These are also, this is the rose aphid. Bring that up full screen. A lot of people just wash these off with a strong stream of water, but there's other ways to control them too. Now, the other thing is that they are protected by ants, typically in Southern California, the Argentine ant. Let's look at our next picture, number three. And these are ants tending aphids. And you can see the ants come up, and these aren't Argentine ants. This is a different ant. But they're collecting the honeydew off of these aphids. And they will protect the aphids from predators. They will protect them from ladybug beetles and anything that wants to eat them. That would be pirate bugs or anything. Lacewings, all that kind of stuff. So typically, if you really want to get your aphids under control, you also have to control the ants, because ants disrupt biocontrol. So if there's things that'll eat those up pretty good, the ants are going to just, literally, you can find really great videos showing ants just grabbing ladybug beetles and throwing them off the plant and protecting their aphids, which they actually farm. They actually can bring the aphids and distribute them on the plant and then come and collect that honeydew. So if you see ant trail going up the trunk of a citrus tree or any fruit tree or any shrub for that matter, you know they're going up there to collect the honeydew from some type of sucking insect, usually aphids, but it can be other types of insects as well. Now the next one we want to look at are mealybugs. And let's take a look at number four. This is the long-tailed mealybug. There are many species of mealybugs. They are actually unarmored scale insects. So these are our scales, but they're not that hard to control. Mealybugs are sexually dimorphic, meaning that the sexes have distinct morphological differences. The males are quite small compared to the females. They do not undergo complete metamorphosis. There are no clear larval, pupal, or adult stages. They all look the same. Little larval stages look just like the adults. They have incomplete metamorphosis. Mealybug females feed on plant sap, normally in roots or other crevices. There are root mealybugs, and those are much more difficult to control. They attach themselves to the plant and secrete powdery wax layer, and that's why they look all white and fluffy. And if we look at our next picture, you can see another species, the Taxus mealybug, number 5. That wax layer protects them. And so it protects them from drying out. The males, on the other hand, are short-lived as they do not feed at all as adults and only live to fertilize the females. A true injustice, a true biological injustice. The most serious pests are mealybugs that feed on citrus, sugarcane, grapes, pineapple, coffee, cassava, ferns, cacti, gardenias, orchids. They can do a lot of damage if they're not brought under control. This next one is the citrus mealybug, and you can bring that up full screen. That's probably an Argentine ant that's tending them. So these maybe it's not black enough. Maybe that's not an Argentine ant. But these small ants, whether it's an Argentine ant or a different species of ant, will collect the honeydew from mealybugs as well and other scale insects. These are unarbored scales. Now there is a small beetle that is known as the mealybug destroyer. And the larva looks just like a mealybug. So if we take a look at our next picture, number 7, take a look at that, bring it up full screen. And you see this. This is actually not a mealybug. This is the larval stage of a beetle that's called the mealybug destroyer. The difference is mealybugs don't move very much. They're sucking insects. They just sit there. And they don't run around. This, what you see in this picture, will walk around very rapidly. Predators typically move around fast. And that's one way you can tell the difference, is if you've got this on your plant and it's walking around pretty quick, that's not a mealybug. I had a call from a homeowner, home gardener, and she said she had this white insect crawling all over her plant. She sent it in. I called her up. I said, "That's the mealybug destroyer. That's really beneficial. Leave it alone." She goes, "Oh, I already sprayed it. I already killed them all." It is really critical that when you're doing pest control for plant materials in gardens or farms or whatever it is, that you correctly identify the pest. In this case, she had a beneficial insect that was actually keeping her mealybugs or anything else, probably won't feed on anything it bumps into, but particularly mealybugs. And she killed it because it was crawly, it was an insect, she didn't like it. So it's important to recognize beneficials and not kill them if you can avoid that. Although generally beneficials won't bring a specific pest under control, you typically need very, very specific biocontrol agents to bring something under control. Now, as I said, mealybugs are actually unarmored scales. There's also armored scale. And if we'll take a look at this next one, this is barnacle scale. And this is a naturally occurring scale, a native scale in California. And it really looks like barnacles. You see it quite frequently on California natives. I think I collected this off of probably a Toyon, which is a native shrub in the chaparral. And there are about 8,000 species of scale insects. Scale insects vary dramatically in their appearance from very small organisms, 1 to 2 millimeters, that occur under wax covers, to shiny pearl-like objects, which you see behind me, to creatures covered with mealy wax. Adult females are almost always immobile. and are permanently attached to the plant they have parasitized. Scale insects' waxy covering makes them quite resistant to pesticides. This is one of the most difficult insects to control. Scale insects have a larval stage called crawlers. So you've got this female that's like the ones behind me in the picture, and they've got this covering, an integument that they've secreted, and it's made out of wax and various materials that they produce. That protects them from any kind of spray. So typically adult scale insects are not controlled easily, especially with the kind of things you want to use on aphids and other soft-bodied sucking insects. Oils, soaps, pyrethrins, the organic stuff, usually won't kill a scale. So if you get a heavy scale infestation, you're typically going to have to use something a little stronger, and it's not going to be organic, or you won't bring it under control. I see we have an email question. Can mealybug, from Jack, can mealybug impact your indoor plants? What solution do you use that will not harm the plants? Also, will they use pests as a host? Well, yes, if they're feeding on the plant's a host. That's just the definition of a host. And yes, they will get all over indoor plants. They love indoor plants, especially cactus and orchids. There are some mealybugs that get all over cactus. We have some new, we have a new cactus mealybug, which is really detrimental to cactus. It really damages the green epidermis or the skin of the cactus. It really screws it up. It makes it, you know, if you're growing it for an ornamental purpose, you don't want it to look bad, you want it to look good. So they will screw it up. Typically for mealybugs, soapy water is very effective. If you have indoor plants, you can just rinse them off with soapy water. I used to take some of my indoor plants and have a little dish of dilute alcohol and a Q-tip, and I'd sit there and clean the plant off with this weak alcohol solution. And so, you know, you can use soapy water. If you want, you can also spray them with an oil product. We're going to talk more about that next week when we talk about integrated pest management. That's our lecture next week is IPM. So I'm getting a little ahead of myself, but that's fine. So usually soapy water, I use about a teaspoon to a gallon. I saw a video today that said use 2 tablespoons to a gallon. That's a lot more than you need, I think. It just doesn't take that much soap. You use soap, not detergent. Dishwashing soap works quite well. Palmolive, any of them, the generic brands that you can get at any supermarket. And just a little bit of soap in the water. In fact, I don't have a dishwasher. I wash my hands in a sink by hand. It saves money by saving me electricity and water. And plus, I can't fit one in my kitchen, unfortunately. But so when I'm washing my dishes and I've got a big pan of soapy water, I can just take a little rag, dip it in the water, and wipe down my plants that are around my kitchen sink. So it's really quite easy to control mealybugs, but you got to stay on top of it. You're probably not going to kill them all the first time you do it. Usually you've got to do it several times, either once a week for several weeks or like twice a week for 2 weeks. If you take them outside, you can spray them with soapy water, and then after maybe an hour, rinse it off. But soapy water works really well to kill mealybugs. And so soapy water won't hurt your cats and dogs. So that's probably the easiest way to do that. Now, where were we? We're talking about scale. So we were talking about how hard it is to control the adults. Well, one of the ways you keep the population suppressed for scale insects is you target the crawlers. So those females obviously don't live forever. They end up just being filled with eggs. The eggs hatch. All the larvae are these little tiny insects, and they crawl. And then they're going to find a place to feed, and they're going to sit down, start feeding, and secrete their covering and become adults. Getting them in the crawler stage is your best advice. And you can get the crawlers with soap or oil or a pyrethrin or a pyrethroid. You know, that'll really get them. But if you want to get the adults, you need to go to a broad-spectrum insecticide, and that's when you need it. You don't want to use it when you don't need it. So our next group, let's look at some more scale insects real quick. There's one I see all the time on cycads. Cycas revoluta, the sago palm. It's not a palm, it's a cycad. Bring that up full screen. And you can see this cycad scale. And it causes little yellow spots on the tops of the leaves. And so if you notice on your sago palm, you've got all these yellow speckling all over. Look on the back side for this scale. And this one is a little more difficult to control. You're going to have to spray frequently and maybe even use a broad-spectrum insecticide. The next one is red date scale, and let's bring that up too. And this one can be difficult to control as well because it gets in between the fronds. So this is red date scale. Here's some of it, but it's in between here. It's all in between these pinnae on this leaf. So they are hard to control. And you might need to treat this with a systemic insecticide to bring it under control. Now, a really interesting scale insect is the cochineal scale that you see on opuntias. Opuntias are the prickly pears or the beaver tail cactus. And here it is. This is a scale insect. If you squish this, the juices are bright red, almost burgundy. And it was used for a long time to dye clothing. And around 1900, there was still an industry based on collecting this. So people would go out and collect it off the wild or native opuntias. And we look at our next one, you can see a very heavy infestation on prickly pear cactus. See how heavy that is on there? It's just covering it solid all in here. I should go get this and bring it in for you so I can squish it. But if you take this and smash it, it will stain your fingers red. And if you put it in hot water, put a little bit of hot water and throw in some white yarn, you can dye it pink. If you put in some more, you can dye it red. If you put in more, you can be almost a burgundy color. So it was the basis of a red dye industry. When synthetic dyes came on, they stopped. It wasn't commercially viable anymore. This can be controlled by washing it off your cactus or spraying with oils and soaps. Now, oils you have to use when it's cool out. But it'll actually be washed off quite easily with a hose. And our next sucking insects are white flies. And they are there are about 1,550 species that have been described. They are another, I didn't mention this about aphids before, but aphids are the number one vector of viruses in plants. White flies are very good vectors of viruses too, and they vector a lot of viruses into lettuce. And when you get a heavy white fly infestation, especially on lettuce, with the virus, it really slams lettuce. So feeding damage can cause economic losses. The disability of white flies to transmit or spread viruses that has the widest impact on global food production. Feeding damage can cause economic losses. That's just a repeat of my previous paragraph. The tomato yellow leaf curl virus was discovered in USA and Florida. That was in 1997. Plant disease is the worst viral disease of the tomato and is transmitted by the white fly, Bemisia argentinifolia, foliae. So white flies can spread viruses both to lettuce and to tomato and probably some other hosts as well. And they are pretty difficult to control. Now, but what you see behind me, bring it up full screen, is the black pupal stage of a white fly. Here's the pupal stages, these black stages. And if we take a look at this next one, the number 14, this is the giant white fly. The giant white fly was introduced from Mexico. Its preferred host, and here you see the adult flies. If you shake the bush, you get all these little tiny white flies flying all over the place. White flies aren't hard to identify. And if we look at our next picture, again, this is white fly on hibiscus. And the nymphs, the larval stage, are on the surface of the leaf down here. And they are producing these long, thin filaments of wax. Wherever white flies walk or do anything, they produce wax. And this particular one, the giant white fly, and they're much bigger than regular white flies, the adults, have these long tendrils of wax that hang down under the leaf. It looks like the plant is growing a beard. And so that's a giant white fly, this particular one I'm showing you. And its preferred host is hibiscus. But it will also go to xylosma, which is a shrub, a popular shrub in landscapes in Southern California. And it'll go to, it can go on citrus and avocado. It has a pretty broad host range. But it's not going to be as dramatic on those hosts like it is on hibiscus. On hibiscus, it's spectacular. And it really trashes the plant if you don't bring it under control. There are some biocontrol wasps that have been introduced to control this, and it had a dramatic impact. You don't see it nearly as much as you did when it first appeared in the late 1990s, and it was everywhere. You couldn't find a hibiscus that wasn't covered with it. Now, it's quite a bit more spotty because there is a wasp that parasitizes the nymph or the larval stage. And so that's brought it under control to some extent, but you'll still get outbreaks on individual hibiscus or some other hosts too. And you can either wash it off with a strong stream water or use oils or soaps. Now let's talk about thrips. Thrips are, let's look at our next couple whiteflies. We've got a couple more whiteflies. Take a look at number 16. This is another picture of whiteflies. You can see what the whiteflies look like as adults. And then look at our next one, which is an adult walked in a spiral. It probably started, well, it's hard to tell exactly where it started, but it wherever it walks, it leaves a trail of wax. And so that's why you see these spiral patterns from whiteflies, is wherever they walk, they leave this trail of wax. Now let's talk about thrips. Thrips is another group of sucking insects. Thrips are tiny, slender insects with fringed wings. Some species of thrips feed on other insects or mites, so there are predaceous thrips or beneficial thrips. And while some feed on fungal spores or pollen, there are about 5,000 species of thrips. And they do not go through complete metamorphosis, they go through incomplete metamorphosis. People have described them as looking like little tiny alligators. So if you bring this up full screen, these thrips are off of spice bush. And you can see they kind of look, of course they got six legs. I didn't mention that before, but insects have six legs. If it has eight legs, it's an arachnid, a spider, a tick, or a mite. So, of course, all insects, their development from the larval stage to adult is really covered by temperature and the environment. So if it's cold, they're usually slower. If it's warm, they're faster. There are over 20 plant-infecting viruses are known to be transmitted by thrips. So this is another insect that can transmit viruses, although aphids, I want to say this over and over again, aphids are the number one vector for viruses. So let's take a look at some other thrip pictures. We got 19. Now we had a new thrip introduced onto Myoporum. Bring this up full screen. Myoporum is a genus, it's a shrub. There's a couple different species. There's one that's a ground cover that's real low and one that gets up to about 10 to 15 feet tall as a shrub. And this thrip showed up and devastated Myoporum. And here's the thrip. Known now as Myoporum thrips. It only feeds on Myoporum. And I don't know if you can see it, but the foliage here is really contorted and twisted and damaged. And it causes the foliage to be twisted and contorted and then defoliate. And if you don't control it, it will kill the Myoporum shrubs. And a lot of people called in who had Myoporum on their slope. And it had it for years, of course. And suddenly, their plants were dying. And a lot of Myoporum is grown along the freeway. And Caltrans, California Department of Transportation, really can't afford to go out and control these pests. If they've got a plant material that has to be sprayed all the time, they're not going to be able to deal with that. So they're just going to let them die. Because they can't afford, it's not, how do you budget for that and the manpower and the expense for thousands of acres of a particular plant that's covered with it. So people call up and they might have a slope that's 40 feet long and 30 feet wide, and it's all Myoporum and it's all dying and they don't want to lose it. So they're using systemic insecticides. And there's a couple they're using. They're using imidacloprid. They may be using bifenthrin under the name Onyx, but you know that's a pyrethroid. And so let's look at our next picture, which is ficus thrips. This is a thrip, bring it up full screen. This is ficus microcarpa, a very common tree or used as a hedge or a street tree throughout Southern California. And you'll see this on the foliage. It's all twisted and black. And this is the ficus thrips. And it pretty much, I only see it on this particular species. It may go to some other ficus species, but I'm not familiar with that. I haven't seen it. And the same thing with Myoporum thrips and this thrips, is the leaves are all twisted and contorted, and the thrip is deep down in the foliage. It's all contorted. So if you use oils and soaps, usually you're not going to control it. It's not going to get to it. Those are contact materials. So usually you have to use a systemic. You can use, like I said, imidacloprid, and there's other systemics as well. Now let's talk a little bit about, sharpshooters. I want to talk a little bit about sharpshooters. Sharpshooters are also sucking insects. Let's take up our first sharpshooter, the red-headed sharpshooter. And the reason that sharpshooters are so important is that they vector scorch diseases. And let's take a look at number 21, the red-headed sharpshooter, and bring that up. This is a native sharpshooter. This is the red-headed. They are little bullet-shaped insects that are not phloem feeders. They are xylem feeders. They feed on the water-conducting tissue in a plant, which is really an important distinction. You will not get sooty mold from sharpshooters because what drips off of them is mostly water. And there's no sugar in it, so you're not going to get mold growing from in it. So let's take a look at some of the other species. The next one is the green sharpshooter, number 22. And so that's the green sharpshooter. The next one is the blue-green sharpshooter. Let's bring the blue-green up. So this one, and they're pretty insects. They're not, you know, this is really, you know, not bad looking. It's a very interesting little guy. But the most important one now, in a way, is the glassy-winged sharpshooter. That's our next one, number 24. And this is an introduced sharpshooter, and it looks a lot like the smoke tree sharpshooter, which I didn't show you. But it's much bigger. It's a third bigger. This sharpshooter is native from Florida all the way to Texas. We know now that the ones we have in California that were introduced sometime prior to 1990 came from Texas. Genetics are wonderful. You can run the genes on any organism, a bacteria, a fungus, a bacteria, an insect, and you can tell an awful lot about them. There's little differences that'll tell you where it came from because it's the same as the ones in that region. So we know now that the glassy-winged sharpshooters we have in Southern California were introduced from Texas. Let's take a look at another picture, number 25. Bring it up full screen. This is also the glassy-winged sharpshooter. So they're pretty good size. And the reason this is important is sharpshooters can acquire a bacteria from infected plants called Xylella fastidiosa. Xylella fastidiosa causes scorch diseases and also causes Pierce's disease of grape. And there's a handful of names for the diseases it causes. In citrus, it's called citrus variegated chlorosis. We don't have that in North America. That only occurs in Brazil. On the eastern seaboard, they have Xylella that infects peach. We don't have it in California. Calm down. It infects peach. It's called peach phony disease. We do have scorch diseases in a lot of plants in California now. We have it, it's been in almond for a long time, but it also now is infecting liquid ambers, olives, crepe myrtles, oleander, killing oleanders now since about 1990. Once a plant is infected with Xylella, it lives in the xylem or the water conducting tissue, it kills the plant. We'll talk more about that when we talk about killer plant diseases in another episode, but I want to show you that. Now, let's talk about beetles. Let's move on to our next picture. Beetles are chewing insects. Now we're going to talk about chewing insects. This is the striped cucumber beetle. Bring it up full screen. This will do a lot of damage to vegetable plants. Beetles are the largest group of insects within the order, the insect order. Their order is Coleoptera. So it's actually a Insects are not an order. Insects are a forgotten the hierarchy now. But Coleoptera is the order for all beetles. There are probably at least 350,000 species, and people speculate that there's a million different species of beetles around the world. There are more described species than in any other order. 25% of all known life forms are beetles. 40% of all described insects are beetles. They feed on plants and fungi, they break down animal and plant debris, and eat other invertebrates. So some beetles eat other beetles or eat other insects. Certain species are agricultural pests. In fact, a lot of them are agricultural pests. The Colorado potato beetle, the boll weevil, which attacks cotton. Other species of beetles are important for controls of agricultural pests. Beetles in the family Cochinellidae are the ladybug beetles. They eat aphids, scale insects, and thrips. Like all insects, beetles' bodies are divided into three sections, the head, the thorax, and the abdomen. Beetles are generally characterized by a particularly hard ectoskeleton and hard forewings. They fly. Most beetles fly. Beetles have mouthparts similar to that of grasshoppers. Grasshoppers and beetles are chewing insects. Caterpillars are chewing insects. So they have mandibles, or their mouthparts, that can chew. The mandibles are a pair of hard, often tooth-like structures that move horizontally to grass, crush, and cut food or enemies. So there is a beetle that was discovered recently, the red palm weevil, and weevils are beetles. And let's go to our this video on the red palm weevil, and then we'll talk more about it. Now, this is an interesting story about the red palm weevil, but let's look at this video first, and then I'll tell you the rest of the story. Let's go to our first video on the red palm weevil.
We're here in beautiful Laguna Beach. This is a typical funky neighborhood in Laguna. We've got sunshine, the ocean, and we've got palm trees. Behind me, the Canary Island date palm, one of the classic landscape palms in coastal Southern California. And it's right here in this neighborhood where one of the world's most damaging insect pests of palm trees has appeared, the red palm weevil. And this weevil was found just right up the street here in a palm tree that had the top fallen off and it landed in the driveway. An arborist was called out to remove it, and he found that the center of the palm had been eaten up and that these very large weevils were inside this palm tree. And this red palm weevil, which is infamous in other parts of the world because of the damage it's done to Canary Island date palms, just like the trees behind me here, as it feeds inside and it weakens the tree and eventually can kill the tree. And the red palm weevil has had an impact here in a very small neighborhood in Laguna Beach. And the challenge now to us is to find the red palm weevil, to see where it is in this neighborhood or if it's anywhere else, and to try to prevent the red palm weevil from establishing here in California, where it is a very, very serious threat to not only landscape palms, but the industry that supports the landscape palms and also our date industry here in California, which is both a producer of dates for consumption and also a supplier of many of the commercial date palms for our landscapes here in Southern California. One of the biggest challenges is finding the red palm weevil. We can go up to a palm tree, we can stare at it, we can look up 30 feet in the air, and we're not going to see the red palm weevil. We can look for very subtle symptoms on the new growth that comes out, but unless we can get right up into the crown of the palm tree and look at the base of these leaves, we really can't confirm that the red palm weevil is in there. We're relying on traps right now in Laguna Beach, traps that use a very, very attractive chemical pheromone or chemical that attracts other palm weevils in. And the weevil uses this to overwhelm a palm tree. When the palm is infested, they release this chemical that attracts other palm weevils to the tree, and together they weaken the tree and they make an area that's very conducive for the development of the weevil inside the palm tree. And in fact, they make it so good that the weevils have no reason to leave the palm tree. They have no reason to go out. And again, this just makes it harder for us to find this weevil. So hopefully when the weather warms up, we're going to see red palm weevils start to fly and be attracted to the traps. But in the meantime, we're trying to get the word out for those that work amongst palm trees and those that work in palm trees to know what to look for and what subtle symptoms can cue us in to palms that may show symptoms of the red palm weevil and currently be attacked by the red palm weevil. When we're talking about damage in the Canary Island date palm or in any other type of large palm, the red palm weevil wants to be deep in the center, the newest, softest leaves, and they get in there. One of the challenges, obviously, are these spines. These are dangerous for anybody trying to get in here, and it makes it very difficult. But if we can cut into the base of this tree and get the base of one of these leaves out, what we can see here are chewing damage where the larvae have fed in internally in the base of the palm, and as they come back out, they form these very distinctive cocoons that are woven out of the palm fiber. And these cocoons can be at the base of the frond or they can fall to the ground beneath the tree. And these are a classic symptom of the red palm weevil. And because of the difficulties in getting in there, if these fall out, it makes the job a lot easier for us to see. And another thing we can find at the base of the tree are these leaf sheaths that fall off. And these came out of the center of the palm when they were growing. And as they came out of the tree, they show some of the damage that the larva made. And they're like Swiss cheese. They've been eaten through so many times as they were wrapped around the center leaf. So we need your help. If you notice any of these signs of damage, like we showed you with the leaf sheaths, please call the CDFA Report a Pest Hotline.
So that was Nick Nissen, the entomologist for the Orange County Agricultural Commissioner's Office, but Nick just retired recently, and he was very involved early on when the red palm weevil was first discovered in Laguna Beach. There was a lot of people were very excited about it because the red palm weevil has decimated palms in Spain and other parts of the world where it has become, you know, firmly established. It really likes Phoenix canariensis, which is the Canary Island date palm, native to the Canary Islands. And you see them all over Southern California. People will pay $20,000 for a full-size Canary Island date palm they planted in their yard. And there's a couple things that are killing them, but this was a real threat. It will go to other palms as well, not just the Canary Island date palm, but also to Washingtonian palms, probably almost any palm, but it has a strong preference for the Canary Island palm. So the story is, they found it on that one palm. They found it on another palm down in Laguna Beach. They treated that palm with a couple of different insecticides. They put out all these traps, and they were never able to trap any beetles, any of the red palm date weevil. And then they tried some other tricks. They had these pheromone traps, and they wouldn't come. So then they started in different parts of the world, not locally, but they tried using cut up chunks of palm tree with the trap, and then they came like crazy. So it's often you've got to tweak your trapping procedure to be able to get the insect. I see we have a phone call. Let's go to our first caller. Terry calling from Pasadena, you're on the air.
Yeah, I had a question about my tomatoes.
Okay.
I pulled them up because they weren't doing too well. They didn't get very big or they didn't produce much fruit. And when I pulled up the roots, they were all bumpy. And I talked to my neighbor about it, and she said that she thought it could be a nematode or something like that. What do you think I have?
Your neighbor is right. If the roots are all bumpy and lumpy, that's almost certainly the root knot nematode. And the root knot nematodes are microscopic roundworms that live in the soil. The vast majority of nematodes are free living. About 80% actually live in the ocean. And then there's a lot of free living nematodes in the soil that don't feed on plants at all, but there's a small set of nematodes that feed on plants. And one of them is the root knot nematode. The genus is Moloidogyne. And once you get a lot of them in the soil, then they really, really damage the host plant. Tomatoes are subject to it, and a lot of other plant materials get nematodes and are susceptible hosts for the root knot nematode. So the principal means of avoiding the damage is rotation. You don't want to grow tomatoes in the same spot year after year after year. Then the nematode populations will build to the point that you get a lot of damage. The other thing is to grow resistant tomatoes that are resistant to root knot nematode. So the heirloom varieties are going to not have that. The modern varieties have that. The other thing you can do is try and suppress them in the soil or kill them. In the old days, you could go out and buy soil fumigants. You used to be able to buy Vapam, which is a soil fumigant. And then that was banned. Prior to Vapam, people using Vapam, you used to be able to buy methyl bromide. Well, you haven't been able to buy methyl bromide for about 40 years, and that's probably a good thing. It's incredibly dangerous, very toxic gas, pretty easy to actually kill yourself with it if you're not careful. But both of those are gone. But there's a really nice way to organically or naturally fumigate your soil, and that is to grow a coal crop. Cabbage is the best one to use. So tear out all your tomatoes and seed in cabbage.
Oh, cabbage, okay.
And grow it and let it head up. You know, it's a winter crop in Southern California, cabbage, because it heads up. Anything that heads up is a winter crop. At the beginning of the show, I was talking about winter crops. So all your head lettuce are also winter crops, and anything that heads up, you know, also broccoli, cauliflower, spinach, these are all winter materials. But so you grow cabbage in about mid-February or so, chop it all up, turn it into the soil. You want to turn it down to about 6 inches deep or even deeper, and then tarp it and seal the edges of the tarp. You dig a little trough around where you grow your tomatoes and fold the plastic in and bury it all along the edge so it traps it. And when that green cabbage material in the soil decays, it gives off the same chemical as Vapam, a sulfur compound that kills nematodes and fungi and bacteria. And this is an organic way to fumigate your soil. It will slam those nematodes. And then next year, so that's a great way to suppress the population and really knock them down. You can use cabbage, you can use mustard, you can use rape. Some people just use winter rye, grass. You broadcast winter rye out, let it get about 4 to 6 inches tall, and then just turn it into the soil. It will have a very similar effect, but I don't think it's as effective as cabbage.
Okay, well, I'll do that. Well, thank you so much for that information.
Okay, well, thank you for calling, and thank you for watching the show. Now, one other thing I would recommend when you're dealing with a root pathogen, such as a root knot nematode, or one of the other root soil-borne diseases that affect either tomatoes or any of your summer vegetable crops, because you can have fusarium, you can have verticillium, you could have phytophthora, there's a whole bunch of things that can be in the soil that will damage your summer vegetables. And is that you need to rotate. So you grew your tomatoes this year and you had a problem with it. Well, in the winter you can grow your cabbage, turn it in, really suppress or knock down the nematode population. You're not going to eradicate it. It's not going to disappear. But next year you shouldn't be growing tomatoes right there. You should grow something like beans or squash or corn. Something that's not solanaceous, you know, so you're not going to grow tomatoes, potatoes, eggplant, or peppers in the same spot because those are all solanaceous. They're all in the nightshade family, and they share the same pests and diseases. I see we have another caller. Let's go to our next caller. Steve from Sylmar, you're on the air.
Yeah, hi. I have one apricot tree, and every year it just give me blooms a lot, but it doesn't bear any fruit. And then on the trunk of the tree, there is lots of those like a gluey thingy, you know, like a gluey liquid, you know.
You mean it's bleeding and oozing sap?
Right.
So it's sticky and gooey?
Right, exactly.
Okay, and how old is this tree?
It's about, I would say, 15 years.
Did you plant it?
Yeah.
Okay. How often do you water it?
Every other day.
And by the way, that's way too frequent. But when you do water it, how long do you water it for?
Not that long, like maybe 2-3 minutes.
Okay. Your first problem is how you're watering. It could be that... Now, did you get a lot of fruit in previous years?
No, every year is doing like that. You know, it just produces
okay.
a lot, but it doesn't give me any fruit.
You're watering all wrong.
Okay.
Nothing is watered. Fruit trees are watered once a month in the spring and the fall, and every 2 weeks in the summer.
Okay.
And when you do water them, you have to put down 3 to 4 inches of water. Do you have sprinklers? How do you water it?
Just like it.
With a hose?
Yeah, with a hose, right.
And you just stand there and spray it?
Right.
Okay, you can't do it that way.
No, I don't just spray, you know, I let like maybe 1 inch or half an inch around the...
Well, do you have a basin that you fill up or do you just spray it on the soil?
On the soil.
Okay. Get a hose in sprinkler. A sprinkler that screws onto the end of your hose. Put it under the tree. You don't want one that shoots way up in the air. You want one that shoots low. You know, that has a low spray.
Okay.
Put it under the tree and put some cups out. Like coffee cups or a tuna can or something that can catch the water.
Okay.
And turn on the sprinkler so it sprays underneath the tree. And run that until you have 3 inches of water in the cups.
Uh-huh.
That's going to take 1 to 2 hours.
Oh, okay.
And you need to do that once a month in the spring. So once in March, April, May, June. And then in July, you're going to start doing that every 2 weeks.
Okay.
The reason you're getting no fruit is, did it set little tiny fruit and then it fell off?
Yeah, sometimes maybe 1 or 2, you know.
Well, if the tree is drought-stressed, if it's not getting enough water, it will not keep its fruit. Even if it sets little tiny fruits in the spring after it flowers, little tiny, if you dry it out, it'll drop them all.
Right, right.
So your primary problem is how you're watering.
Okay.
Do you fertilize the tree?
Not that much, sometimes.
Okay, you want to fertilize 3 times a year, spring, summer, and fall. And you want to use a fertilizer that's made for fruit trees or for vegetable gardens. You don't want to use a lawn fertilizer. You want to use like a citrus avocado food or anything
right.
that's meant for fruit trees.
Yeah, I'm using that sometimes.
Okay, you should use it 3 times a year. You should also put down a thick layer of compost underneath the canopy of the tree on the surface of the soil twice a year, spring and fall.
Okay.
Mulch it heavily. Do you prune the tree every winter?
Yeah, I do that.
Yeah, because every winter, you know, apricots are stone fruits, like peaches, nectarines, apricots, plums, cherries. We call those stone fruits. They're all in the genus Prunus. They're all very similar. You have to prune them hard every winter. You take about 2/3 of the wood in order to encourage new growth that flowers more and makes more fruit.
Oh, okay.
So you need to prune every winter after it loses its leaves.
Okay.
There's a great video showing you how to prune peaches, and you're going to prune your apricot the same way. It's called the open center pruning technique. And you can find that on YouTube from the University of Massachusetts Fruit Tree Advisor. And later in the semester, another broadcast, we're going to talk about pruning stone fruits and pruning trees in general. And I'll show I'll show that video. But if you go look for it today or sometime during the week, you can find that video that shows you how to prune stone fruits with an open center technique. So now, but your most important thing is how you're watering. You're never going to get you're never going to have a healthy tree or a tree that performs well in the landscape if you water like that, if right. you only water for like 5 minutes, all that, you're only going to water about a half an inch of soil. And most of that water is going to evaporate and go off in the air. And, not, and it's not going to get to the roots. It's not going to get absorbed up into the tree. You want to water 2 feet of soil. To even 3 feet of soil would be excellent. And to do that, you have to put down 3 or 4 inches of water. And it takes an hour or two. Okay?
Okay.
So the first thing you got to do is start watering correctly. Now, for September, you're going to water twice this month. In October, you're going to go back to watering once.
Okay.
And then in November, you water once. December, January, February, you water once if it does not rain. But you don't have to put down a full 3 to 4 inches. You can put down 2 or 3 inches in the winter months because you're just trying to prevent the soil from going bone dry.
Okay.
So try that. And next spring, in March, deep water the tree.
Okay.
You know, that takes a couple hours. Most lawn sprinklers apply at about 2 inches an hour. Mm-hmm. You would have to run lawn sprinklers for about 1.5 to 2 hours in order to water a fruit tree. Whether it's citrus or stone fruits or avocado or persimmon or pomegranate, doesn't matter. To water the soil to a depth of 2 to 3 feet, you need 3 to 4 inches of water. Okay?
Okay. All right, thank you so much.
That should help a lot.
Thank you, bye-bye.
And we have another question. It says, my tomatoes have been decimated by red spider mites. This is from Brian. What can I do to save my remaining plants? Are there any natural solutions? Well, you could, you know, natural solutions, you could order predaceous mites that will eat them. But I don't think that's very effective, depending on how badly infested they are. I mean, if they're covered with webs and the foliage is all yellow and speckled, it's too late. They're trashed. But if it's just starting, if you see just a little bit of webbing and there's maybe just a few branches that are speckled, you need to spray with soapy water. I would use soapy water, and you can use a teaspoon to a gallon or a tablespoon to a gallon, and I don't think you'd ever need more than a tablespoon to a gallon, but you got to spray fairly frequently, and you got to spray at least once a week for 3 weeks, and if it's really, you know, starting to take off and you're getting a lot of spider mite, then you need to probably spray twice a week. You got to really thoroughly spray the plant. You got to get underneath the leaves and hit the back sides of the leaves. That's where most of the mites are. And so you can use any dishwashing soap. You could use an oil as well. Oils are very effective, but it's too hot right now for oils. Oils will burn plants if you spray them when it's over 90 degrees. But there's Volk oil, Sunspray Ultrafine oil, neem oil. Now there's other all sorts of oils on the market. There's oils, you know, canola oil is being sold as a pesticide to control insects. Mint oil is being used to control insects. Oils are non-toxic. They are organic. They cover the insect in oil, and in this case, it's a mite. It's an arachnid. It's not an insect, but it's the same method to actually kill the insect. It prevents it from breathing. So then they die. Soaps are very effective. I saw a video saying today on YouTube saying use 2 tablespoons of oil. I mean 2 tablespoons of soap. And I think that's more soap than you need. But so I would just use 1 tablespoon. I doubt if using 2 is going to be phytotoxic and hurt the plant, but it's not necessary to use quite that much. You can buy soaps too. You can buy insecticidal soaps, and it'll say how much to use on the bottle. But if you've got a bottle of Dawn or some other dishwashing soap, then you need to kind of make up your own recipe and see what works well. And my experience is somewhere between a teaspoon to a tablespoon to a gallon. But and the other thing is, you know, typically I don't see a lot of mites in the early spring or through the spring months. But they'll come on strong as soon as we get warm. So you want it next year, it may be too late for your tomatoes this year. My tomatoes have a lot of mites, and they really did all their production early in, you know, through the summer months, and there's really no tomatoes left, so I tore them all out. And I want to get ready because next weekend I want to start my winter materials. I want to start my peas. I want to start some more lettuce. And there's, you know, there's everything else you can want, might want to grow. Broccoli, cauliflower, spinach, Brussels sprouts. If you're into a winter garden, now's when you want to plant. So I'm just going to toss my tomatoes. They're really done. I'm not going to get any more tomatoes out of them. And get ready for my winter garden. The other thing I like to grow in the winter is cilantro, because it bolts and flowers in the summer, and you don't get the juvenile leaves, which is the flavor. Now, let's just talk a little bit more about beetles. We saw the striped cucumber beetle, which it really does a lot of damage. And beetles and grasshoppers and caterpillars can do a lot of damage. These are the chewing insects. The next one we want to look at is the tin-lined June beetle. And this is an interesting beetle. The larva stage actually feeds on pine tree roots, and the adult beetle feeds on the pine trees too. It's not a big pest, but it's a pretty beetle, and occasionally it comes into the lab. The next one is the green fruit beetle. And we do get a lot of calls on this beetle, but this beetle usually doesn't, it's a native beetle. And if you flip it over, now you can see right along here, this shiny turquoise color. The top is this kind of dusty green. And they are slow flyers, and they make a pretty loud noise. You'll hear them coming. They're slow, clumsy flyers. The larvae are quite large white grubs that you find in mulch piles. Now, this beetle does feed on fruit. It's called the green fruit beetle. It's not Japanese beetle. And a lot of people see this and think, oh, I've got Japanese beetle. No, you don't. Japanese beetle doesn't occur west of the Rockies. It only occurs on the eastern United States, although it's constantly being introduced and being found, but it isn't established or here. It's found in cargo holds and planes occasionally. But currently, we don't have Japanese beetle in California. But this is the green fruit beetle. It will rasp or chew at fruit, like peaches, soft fruits. And it usually there aren't enough of them to cause much of a problem. This next one, the spotted cucumber beetle. This one does cause a lot of damage, quite a lot of damage, and something that needs to be controlled in a vegetable garden. Does a lot of leaf damage. Let's look at the next one is the Altissa flea beetle. And you can see the damage it's doing to the leaf. It's skeletonizing the leaf. These spots here are where it's been feeding. And in high populations, you know, beetles can do a lot of damage. Here's our next one is the elm leaf beetle. Of course, there are literally tens of thousands of beetles, hundreds of thousands of beetles, and they do a lot of damage. And now this is the elm leaf beetle. It can defoliate elm trees and is causing a lot of problems on elms in various areas of the western United States. And there's also the alder leaf beetle, which is the next one we're going to look at. Number 32. Now, sometimes it's the adult that's causing most of the problems. Sometimes it's the larva. Here you see the larva right here. These are the larval stages of the elm leaf beetle, and the larva is skeletonizing the leaf. And if you get high populations, it can defoliate the tree. Now, let me just say that there's two ways to kind of control beetles. One is to use a systemic insecticide that you apply to the roots, and it takes up into the canopy of the tree or shrub, and then anything that feeds on the leaves will be killed. The other way is to use a product called spinosad. Spinosad is specifically for chewing insects. It works quite well for caterpillars, beetles, and grasshoppers, and anything that chews. It'll control leaf miners too, and we'll talk about leaf miners here in a minute. But let's talk a little bit more about the red palm weevil. Let's go to our second video clip. Again, this is Don Hodel, a professor at UC Riverside, collecting palm weevil larvae in Malaysia. And this is a great clip, and I have to share this with you. And I'll talk about more why this is such a great clip after we watch it. Let's look at this clip. Here we go. Stand by.
for the Center for Invasive Species Research at the University of California, Riverside. On May 25, 2011, a Canary Islands palm suspected of being infested with red palm weevil was treated in a private residence at Laguna Beach. An observation window approximately 6 to 7 feet wide was cut into the crown of the palm. Here you can see a skilled palmero cutting away the fronds. The fronds that were dropped to the ground showed feeding damage caused by red palm weevil. When we cut into the base of the fronds with a hatchet, we could see feeding tunnels made by the larvae of red palm weevil, and some of these larvae included cocoons. These cocoons were empty. The adult weevils had emerged prior to the cutting of these fronds. Feeding damage was extensive in these frond bases, as evidenced by cutting into the fronds with the hatchet. You can see extensive feeding damage, pupal cases, and pupation chambers that the larvae had made into the bases of these fronds. You can see more pupal cocoons and weevil frass being pulled out of those feeding tunnels. This type of damage can kill these palm fronds, but in this instance it wasn't severe enough to cause palm frond mortality. The age of these fronds was estimated to be approximately 3 to 4 years of age. All palm fronds after they were removed from the tree were destroyed by chipping and then taken to a certified landfill and then buried. This was a precaution to prevent the accidental movement of red palm weevil throughout Southern California. After the observation window had been cut, it was treated with a contact insecticide, and then the soil immediately below the palm was pressure treated with imidacloprid, and then the trunk was sprayed with dinotefuran, a rapid uptake neonicotinoid. These three treatments were to provide control of red palm weevil in the infested palm tree.
So that was a different video than I was expecting, but that points out a really important point, is that after that tree was treated and traps were placed around Laguna, they never found any more weevils. So here's an interesting case where we discovered an exotic pest in California, but an aggressive response, it wasn't really intended that way. They were just really wanting to know how many were down there and where they were, and they treated any trees they found. But I guess they got there early, because since then, we've never found another one in California. So keep your eye out. If you have the palms in your garden, look to see if you're getting, you know, those pupal cases. They're about this big, and they're all made of palm, this fibrous material, and they'll be at the base of the palm tree. If you find that, you got a lot of reasons to worry. But the video clip I wanted to show you was this next one, which is also the first one. It's palm frond exploration of red palm weevil. Let's take a look at number three, because I wanted to point out one aspect of these palm weevils that may surprise you. Let's take a look at our next clip. Hopefully we're ready to go with that one too.
We've eaten these larvae cooked with our colleagues here from Lonsom, but now I think it's time to man up and try and eat one in the raw like some of these fellows do. So you can see we have a big grub here. It's not the preferred life stage. Large head capsule on them, which I won't be eating. You can see him biting me.
So because he knows he's going
to
die.
It's time for man to bite back.
He did it.
No, just kidding. Actually, they are very sweet.
Very sweet?
Very sweet.
I'm surprised. The skin is chewy. But they are pretty sweet to eat.
Very sweet.
So I've taken all the guts out. This is the exoskeleton, now the cuticle. They're still ground up. A few splinters. From the inside.
This is where it came from right now.
Okay.
But yeah, these are edible raw. They don't taste disgusting and they don't have a foul texture.
Adi, it's your turn.
No, I now I give it for you because
I'm just
I have many, many opportunity here, so
thank you, Adi. Adi's a gentleman. He's sharing because he can eat these anytime.
Yes.
Here's the rest of Mark's dinner.
So we've had a pretty good capture out of this log. It's probably about 1/4 kg, at least, of pure protein here. And this is a food source that the FAO is encouraging local indigenous farmers like these fellows
to grow. It's a very economic way to produce high quality, high volumes of protein.
It is not a disgusting thing to eat at all. Not bad. Well, actually, just to prove it, I'll eat another one.
You eat more?
It's sweet. I'm really surprised. They're quite sweet to eat. It's just that the cuticles are a bit chewy.
Yeah.
But you could take that out and just throw it away or crunch it up. Swallow it.
So that's Don Hodel, an entomology professor, or professor of entomology at UC Riverside, who works on exotic pests introduced into California. And he got very involved in that. And soon after that video came out, he had a product, Don Hodel's A1 caterpillar sauce. Just kidding. But the funny thing about this, or the interesting thing about this particular weevil, the red palm weevil, or date weevil, palm weevil, I should say, is that where it is native and indigenous in Malaysia, the grubs, the larva, is a food source. And the government is interested in trying to rear them as a high-protein food that naturally occurs where they are. And it is believed that it was actually introduced by someone in Laguna who wanted to eat them. Because why would you bring that weevil? And how did it get to Laguna Beach? Laguna Beach, it's interesting, it's surrounded by about 5 miles of chaparral. So there's no palm trees close by Laguna, except right in Laguna. So you've got that highway that leads in, but it's all rolling chaparral hills surrounding Laguna Beach. And so that probably helped contain this weevil, and it didn't get out to the rest of the state. So who brought it in? It's hard to say. And in fact, what you see here is the grub. This grub is a different grub. That's actually the grub from Diaprepes wood weevil, but it will look just like that, almost identical. Now, let's just go back one picture to number 33 and bring that up. This is the Diaprepes root weevil, and the story here is not so nice because this was introduced into California, and it feeds on the roots of a lot of trees, particularly citrus. So it's also known as the citrus root weevil, and it can have various colors. And here it's kind of this yellowish, but it can be orange or red, and it's got these black stripes. And here's the larval stage. If we take a look at our next picture, the larval stage for the Diaprepes root weevil. And this is the stage that actually feeds on roots. And so I'll tell you the whole life cycle here in a minute. Let's take a look at the next one, number 35. And you can see the pupal stage. This is the pupal stage for the Diaprepes root weevil. So let's talk a little bit about the Diaprepes root weevil and why it's such a disaster for California. Well, when it was first introduced and first discovered, I think we found it in Long Beach and in Orange County, and probably in San Diego County as well. There was a state interior quarantine. California Department of Food and Agriculture had a quarantine and tried to eradicate or control this. There was a lot of effort gone into it, a lot of rules about moving stuff. Now, it has a huge host range. This Diaprepes root weevil, or the Caribbean root weevil, or the citrus root weevil, goes by all those names. It has different color variants. Will feed on palms. It was in Long Beach, it was feeding on coral trees, Erythrina. But it loves citrus. So it got introduced into some lemon groves down in the Fallbrook area. And you could walk up and just push a lemon tree over, just push it over. Because it feeds, the larval stage that we just looked at feeds on the roots. So here's a root, it in a kind of a corkscrew or a spiral fashion, it feeds on the root and does a lot of damage to the root. Then you get a lot of decay and rot in that root because it's so damaged. But if you get enough of those on the root system, it really decimates the root system. And then it'll pupate, and you can see the pupa behind me, and it emerges as the weevil. The weevil comes out of the ground and crawls up the trunk, goes into the foliage and starts feeding on the foliage of the tree. So this is a great beetle. And so one of the ways you'll notice your infestation is the new growth on the tree, the edges of the leaves are all scalloped and chewed on. So a bunch of other important agricultural pests have been introduced into the state since this one. And the state just doesn't have the resources to respond to every one of these. And some of these other ones that showed up are just as important, if not more important. So they had to shift their focus to the newest pests that were being introduced and hope they could control those. But this, the interior state quarantine expired. They just said, okay, it's all over the place now. There's nothing you can do about it. They tried a handful of things. Various, you know, agricultural researchers tried a variety of things. One of the things that worked really well was putting down one of these weed barriers on the surface of the soil. And then when the adults tried to come up, they couldn't get through it. And so then the adults couldn't get up and feed on the tree and lay the eggs. Now the life cycle, we've seen most of it, the adults feed on the foliage and then lay eggs on the leaves. The eggs hatch and then the larvae just fall off the leaf and hit the ground, burrow into the ground and start feeding on the roots. So, and then they go through several molts and stages and then they pupate as adults and go up the trunk and feed on the foliage. They don't fly very far. They aren't gonna be moved very much on their own. But if you've got adults in a tree and the tree gets pruned and then you throw that in a truck and drive someplace and the beetles are flying out of the truck for 10 or 20 miles while you drive it to a landfill, we can move it quite efficiently. The beetle itself is only gonna fly, you know, a few hundred feet, not even a mile. But with cars and trucks, you know, we can, you know, drive them hundreds of miles and really distribute them. I haven't seen a lot of it, but these plastic mats that are meant primarily to suppress weeds, if you put them around a citrus tree and prevent, so you actually have a barrier that prevents the adults from coming up through the ground and getting up and laying eggs in the canopy, and you can break the life cycle. You can also treat the tree with imidacloprid. We'll talk more about imidacloprid, but it's a systemic insecticide that's taken up by the roots. Now, another beetle that's extremely important, and I'm going to talk more about some other beetles that are important. But this next one I want to show you is an oak pest. It's called the gold-spotted oak borer. Let's bring that up full screen. And you can see this here. It's got six gold spots in pairs. And this gold-spotted oak borer is now decimating California coastline oaks in the Cleveland National Forest, which is down in Orange County and San Diego County. And it has a rather distinct exit hole in the trunks of oaks when it leaves. Let's look at our next picture, the oak borer exit holes. Bring that up full screen and we'll see if we can get a good look at this. They are D-shaped. If you look at this one right here, right there, and right there, that one shows it pretty good. They are D-shaped. Actually, if a D would go like this, but it doesn't matter which way you put it. This is the kind of hole they leave when they exit the tree, which is kind of unique. Most wood-boring beetles that get into the trunks of trees would leave a nice circular hole. This one leaves these D-shaped, here's another one. Now, what's it do to oaks? It kills them, unfortunately. Let's take a look at our next picture, number 38, which is oak borer damage. Bring it up full screen and we'll see if we see that all these trees in here, all these oaks, are dead. So down in the Cleveland National Forest, they're seeing areas with 80, 90% mortality rates. And it will eventually be 100%. And part of the problem is our severe drought. It's not helping at all. Because some of our other wood borers that go into oaks, like the western oak borer I've forgotten the name. There's another borer, the Nautilus wood borer. So with drought and with, you know, this gold-spotted oak borer and then some others, I have an email question. I'll get to that real quick. Is killing a lot of oaks. And now the gold spotted oak borer is clearly native to Arizona. How did it get to California? Well, it got here with firewood. So you cut down a dead tree somewhere, you cut it up into firewood, it's filled with the beetles, you pack it up in your truck, you come someplace for vacation, you know, camp, and you bring all this firewood hundreds of miles, and then maybe leave it behind, maybe you didn't burn it all. Or while it's sitting there, before you burn it, the beetles come out and fly off. So there's many examples of really serious pests that are wood borers into trees, and the way we move them around is firewood, almost exclusively. They're not going to get here on their own. Nellie asks, so this is the bug responsible for forest fires in Southern California. Yes and no. These dead trees in the Cleveland National Forest are a tremendous fire hazard, and they're going to add to our already tremendous fire hazard. But forest fires in Southern California occur naturally. The chaparral is predisposed to burn. It should burn on a regular basis. So with these severe droughts, we're going to get a much more intense fire hazard than we had if we could get some decent rain in the winter. Trees are drought stressed. They're attacked by pine bark. You know, the pines are going to be attacked by pine bark beetle. The oaks are going to be attacked by western oak borer or nautilus, or in this case, the gold spotted oak borer. And then they're going to die. And now you got dead trees in the landscape, and they are all fire hazards. So yes, this bug increases the fire hazard, but it is not solely responsible for the fire hazard. We'd have the fire hazard whether it was here or not. So the answer is yes and no. It's not responsible for all the forest fires, but it is responsible for a dramatic increase in the fire hazard in the Cleveland National Forest, unless you can get in and cut down tens of thousands of oak trees, which really is not possible. They can do that around campgrounds, but they can't go out in the whole forest and cut down every dead tree. Let's talk about grasshoppers. Let's look at our next grasshopper. Grasshoppers are interesting pests. They don't usually cause a lot of damage unless you have very, very high numbers. But they are chewing insects. They come and go. So you have to use something that's appropriate to control chewing insects. And I mentioned spinosad before, and that's very effective. Let's look at our next picture, which is another grasshopper. There's a lot of different species of grasshoppers. They go through incomplete metamorphosis, so little ones turn into big ones. And but typically, they're not going to be a serious pest threat until you get a lot of them. And if you spray something like oils and soaps or pyrethrin or even something like 7 or malathion or any kind of broad spectrum insecticide, those are contact materials. You'll kill the grasshoppers that might be in the tree right now or in the shrub right now, but they're going to fly, you know, they're going to die, and then tomorrow more are going to fly in. So those are not effective ways to control chewing insects, and so you have to use something that has a little residual activity. Now, let's look at our next picture, which is the salt marsh moth. And this is just, I use this picture just to show you a caterpillar. Caterpillars are major agricultural pests. Most of them, the ones that are significant pests, are moths. Moths fly almost exclusively at night, and the caterpillars, of course, are doing all the damage. The moth isn't doing much damage. Now, I use this as my mystery pest today, and let's go to our overhead again, and I'll tell you what this is, because no one's guessed. No one's called up to guess. I've had a few email questions, but take a look at this on our overhead, and here they are. This is the tobacco hornworm. There are two hornworms we find quite frequently on tomatoes and other solanaceous crops. That would be, this particular one was on pepper. Now, if you notice, come in here and look closely at it. I don't know if we can get a little closer to it. And let's see what I got here. You see these white stripes on it. Now, that's what tells you it's tobacco. You see these white stripes? There's one white stripe. That's the tobacco hornworm. The tomato hornworm has a V-shaped stripe or a chevron type. It goes down and back up. So that makes this the tobacco hornworm. They turn into sphinx moths. Let's look at our next picture. And these will turn into this. Bring it up full screen. This is a moth. It's a sphinx moth. It actually will fly during the daytime, which is quite unusual for moths. Almost all moths fly at night. So if you see these flying around, you can bet they're laying eggs on something, and the caterpillars are going to grow up and feed on your plants. Now these hornworms, the two hornworms you get on tomato, you can get them also on pepper and potato and eggplant, which are all solanaceous. And here I'm going to herd this guy in. These are actually going into our collection for the Los Angeles County Agricultural Commissioner. And I don't want them to escape. In fact, I had to keep them in the refrigerator so they don't pupate. These are so large that they are only days away from creating their pupal case, or their cocoon, and then turning into a sphinx moth. Now, if you look back here, say you see that your tomato plant has lost half its foliage, and you see this big black, these black droppings all over the place. If you look on the overhead, this is the frass. Look how big this frass is. This is what they poop. Even though they're green, they can be hard to find on the plant. If you see this, you know you got it. Now, caterpillars are pretty easily controlled with an organic insecticide called BT. BT is Bacillus thuringiensis. It's a bacteria. You spray it on the plant. The caterpillars eat it. They stop feeding immediately. Within a day or two, they're dead. Very, very effective. Now, the next one, let's see what we want to talk about, grasshoppers. Let's just talk about grasshoppers, just backtrack just a minute. Grasshoppers, how many are there? There are about 11,000 species of grasshoppers, range from monophagous, meaning they feed on one plant, to polyphagous that feed on almost anything. If there's anything else, of course, they are in the Orthoptera order. Now, we talked about caterpillars. Of course, they're in the Lepidoptera, which includes butterflies and moths. And let me just talk briefly about how you can tell the difference between butterflies and moths. Butterflies fly during the day. Moths fly at night. Butterflies are usually colored, very colorful. Moths are usually grays and dull colors. Caterpillars usually have a very thin body. Caterpillars usually have a short, fat body. And then antennas. The antennas on moths are usually clubbed. Let's go back to the sphinx moth and bring it back up, our number 41, and bring it up full screen. I want to just take a look at this moth, so I don't say something incorrect about distinguishing the two. Bring it up full screen. And the antenna are feathery. I don't know if you can see that right there. They're kind of feathery or fringed. And on butterflies, they're clubbed. So usually the bright colors flying during the day and having a skinny body and clubbed antenna, and you have a butterfly. Now, some butterfly caterpillars, of course, caterpillars feed on plants. So there are some butterflies whose caterpillars are a problem. The yellowtail, or swallowtails, yellowtail's a fish. Swallowtail butterflies, the caterpillar feed on citrus. Now, they're not a significant or major pest of citrus, but they can chew on the leaves, and so they can be a little bit of a problem. Now, let's take a look at our next picture, which is the citrus leaf miner moth. We're talking about moths, bring this up. This is a teeny little moth, probably an eighth inch to a quarter inch in size. You're not going to see them flying around. They fly around at night, but you're going to see the damage on your trees. Take a look at our next picture, which is the citrus leaf miner moth damage. Here you see this tunnel in the leaf, and this white line is actually the poop that the caterpillar leaves behind. And I don't know if this picture includes the actual larva. So the caterpillar from that moth we just looked at is inside the leaf. That's why it's called a leaf miner. There are many different kinds of leaf miners. I see leaf miners evidence on tomatoes. I've seen it on zinnias. I've seen it on just about any plant you can think of. And if you take the leaf that has this little serpentine or snake-like pattern, like this leaf does behind me, and you put it in a jar and let it emerge and pupate and emerge as an adult, you'll figure out what it is. Now, depending on the host, it might be a fly, it might be a beetle. In this case, it's a moth. So, how do you control this? Well, spinosad works quite well. It's interesting on citrus, in the spring with your new flush of growth, you'll get all those other sucking insects we talked about. You'll get aphids and mealybugs and scale and whitefly on your new growth in March. And so you'll need to spray with soapy water or oils in March, usually once a week for about 3 weeks, you know, really knock it down and get it under control. But this moth is not active until about mid-June to the beginning of July. It's too cold in the spring for the moth to be active. And so you don't need to spray for it or do any control for the citrus leaf miner until about mid-June. Now, some people have reported that this leaf miner traps are very effective at controlling the citrus leaf miner. The traps are little white triangular traps with a sticky board and a pheromone attractant that attracts the male moths. If you put one of those traps out in June, about mid-June, replace it in July, replace it in August, replace it in September, you can trap the male moths, and then the females won't be able to mate and you won't get any eggs or any leaf miner in your citrus leaves. If you have a lot of citrus in your neighborhood and there's a lot of moths, you're going to get mated females coming into your yard laying eggs, and then the traps aren't going to be effective. So some people say that the trap worked great for them and it completely eliminated all the damage on their plant, and other people said, well, the trap didn't work. If the trap doesn't work, then you're going to need to spray with spinosad. Spinosad has a 10-day residual, and so if you spray about twice a month, starting with your first spray around June 15th, you can control for the citrus leaf miner. And let's see where we're at here. I'm getting all my notes confused. We talked about caterpillars. Let's go back and cover a few more notes about caterpillars. There are about 180,000 species of Lepidoptera. That includes butterflies and moths in 128 families. Estimates of species suggest that the order may have more species than is among the four largest and most successful orders. And the others are Hymenoptera, which are the social insects, bees and wasps. Diptera are flies, and Coleoptera are the beetles. And those are four giant orders. Species of the order Lepidoptera are commonly characterized as being covered in scales, having two large compound eyes and elongated mouth part called a proboscis or proboscis. Of course, the larvae are called caterpillars and are completely different in form, so they have complete metamorphosis. Some 11,300 species are from North America and 10,000 from Australia. And Lepidoptera, particularly moths, are major pests in agriculture, and it's the caterpillars who do all the damage. Some species of Lepidoptera are pollinators of flowers, but not all. So we've covered our kind of our introductory into insects. Let me talk about some other insects, wood-borne insects. We talked briefly about the gold-spotted oak borer, but there are pine bark beetles. There's a lot of different bark beetles that are out there. And the way you protect pines from pine bark beetle is you deep water them once a month. If you drought stress them, if you water them once a week for just 10 minutes, that's not enough. You got to water them once a month for a couple hours. You got to put 3 to 4 inches of water. Water them 2 to 3 feet. Then you don't need to water them for the rest of the month. We have one more call. Let's go to our last call today. And Nancy calling from Pacoima, you're on the air.
Hi. Actually, it's not me with the moths. It's a friend of mine, and it's not like from the garden,
She has a lot of bowl things from her mom that passed away, and she gets, I guess they got out of the bag, and they're in her house. You know, I can't tell you day or night because I haven't seen them, but can she do for that?
So she has bugs coming from her garden going into her house?
I don't know where they came from, but she told me she opened up a bag of her mom's sweaters, you know, like wool sweaters, and from then on, she just had them, you know.
So moths. You know, she has moths. Okay. Well, there are a variety of moths that are significant pests inside of homes, and there are caterpillars that will feed on wool, and they'll, of course, eat holes in your sweaters. And then there are the pantry moths that you know, the caterpillars or the larvae are feeding on flour products or any kind of grain.
Well, she says they're in the kitchen, too, so they're probably that.
Yeah, she's got two different moths, or in effect, you can have several different moths. Uh-huh. Now, unfortunately, the mothballs that people used to use, the naphthalene, I don't think you can use that anymore. So people use cedar to try and discourage
cedar.
Them.
Yeah, I told her about cedar blocks, but I thought, you know, she's got a big house, you know, like a 3-bedroom house, 4-bedroom.
Well, so she probably wants to...
How many cedar blocks per room?
Look through her closet really closely and get any wool. And now she can either try and freeze. I'm not sure what to do with them feeding on the wool. You can get pantry moth traps for the kitchen. She needs to go
pantry
through her...
Pantry moth traps.
Yeah, you can get them at Osh or anywhere, and the pantry moths. Little white trap with a pheromone attractant. You need to keep those in your cupboards, a fresh one every month.
Okay, and you said you get them where?
You put it in your cabinets in your kitchen.
No, but you get them like, you know, Home Depot.
Oh, I get them at Osh. You can get them at Home Depot. You can get them anywhere.
Okay.
And then you need to go through all your stored grain products and see if they're infested.
I think she's already probably thrown that stuff out.
If you go out and buy a new bag of flour, it's very possible there's already eggs in there. So put it in the freezer for a couple days.
Okay.
Freeze any new grain products. You can put them in plastic containers like Tupperware or glass storage so that the moths can't get to it and lay eggs in it.
I had a problem years ago. Now, cereal, everything goes in my refrigerator, you know, just so that I don't ever have the problem.
You're right. If you keep grain products in your refrigerator, it's too cold for the moths, and they don't get access to it there. But it can be in dog food. It can be in flour or rice or spaghetti or cookies or almost anything that has any type of grain product to it. And so you need to look at them all. Throw them all out if they're infested, or freeze the ones that don't appear to be infested in case it's just there and you don't see it. But so try that, and thank you for your call. We've run out of time. We'll be back next week when we're going to talk about integrated pest management. See you then.